at the name of Jesus, no other name, redeeming name, no other name, like the name of Jesus, no other name, redeeming name, no other name. Cut up your demand. I'm calling you today. Make me whole again. Woo! Jesus, oh, cut up your demand. I'm calling you today. Make me whole again. Oh,
no other name.
No one is like the name of Jesus. Redeemer.
Once again,
yeah,
it's your one and only Franklin Adams.
Bring it out.
Love for records.
Yeah. Bring it out.
Let's go, let's go.
Oh.
DB1.
Papa got it too much. The way you bless me, I never see such. Can't deny this. The love you show on me is so much,
so much, so much.
Can someone explain this?
Explain this.
You love me, you die for me even before I exist. So I can't resist all the least you.
The least you.
Your love for me is enough to trust you.
Shall we pray together? Our Father and our God, we want to thank you because it has pleased you to bring us together that you may bless us. I pray you bless your children as they listen and as they hear. Open our eyes that we may see. Open our ears that we may hear. Open our hearts that we may understand. And let your name be glorified. In Jesus' mighty name, I pray. Amen. Today I shall be speaking on deceptive strategies to watch. We are trying to talk about how youths can get involved in healthy entrepreneurship. And today I wish to zero in on certain deceptive strategies that must be watched and that must be taken care of. I'd like to take my reading from Luke chapter 15, from verses 11 to 20, as we zero in on deceptive strategies that must be watched. Luke chapter 15, from verse 11. And he said, a certain man had two sons, and the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falleth to me. And he divided it unto them. And on not many days after, the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, and there wasted his substance with riotous living. And when he had spent all, there arose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would fain have filled his belly with the husk that the swine did eat, and no man gave unto him. And when he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and I am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he arose and came to his father. But when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. Hallelujah. The scriptures we've just read is a scripture that is well known to almost everybody. Those who study the Bible, is a very well known story in the Bible. And that is a story that people have called today the story and the parable of the prodigal son. The younger son said to his father, Father, give me that which falleth unto me. that I may have my inheritance. And the father gave to him. I have always said that a will cannot come into effect until the testator is dead. But this young man rose up before while the father was yet alive and said, Father, give me that which is my own inheritance. Well, to so many will say, well, you couldn't even wait for your father to die. And you are asking your father to share his will, what the father gave him. And that tells me that there are certain strategies that may look proper, that may look right, that may look absolutely without any fault. But in those strategies, if we do not take time, those strategies will destroy us. And today, as I speak to youths, I'd like to tell you that there are certain deceptive strategies that you must take care of and watch. Otherwise, it will destroy you. Strategy number one, ambition without articulation. Any man that has ambition without articulation is making a shipwreck of his ambition. Any man that has an ambition without articulating it, if it is right, will end up a miserable wreck. This young man needed money. This young man wanted to have something to do. He wanted to do business probably. He could have asked the father, Father, please give me some money. But he went on to ask for his inheritance. That was an ambition too much without articulation. Give me the portion of my inheritance that belongeth unto me. And he was very careful to say that belongeth unto me. That made it so look so wonderful that he was not asking for more than was required. But it was an ambition without articulation. Too much in a haste to collect that which was his even before the father was declared dead. Too much in the haste. He wanted his dream achieved, but he refused to think. Any man that wants to achieve his dream must learn to think. Toyota said, good thinking, good product. Any man who does not think cannot achieve. So regardless of the ambition we have in life, we must learn to be articulative. For him, it is profit at all costs, no matter the price. So many good ambitions have been destroyed because they lack proper articulation. Articulate your dreams today and let your dreams be well guided. Number two, becoming without being. In verse 13, the Bible told us that not too long after, the young man got what he wanted. He got the money he needed. He got what he wanted from his father. And not too long after, he left. So many young ones today who want to run into a business or want to become what they want, they have failed to pay attention to proper mentoring, proper discipleship, proper fathering. They refuse to come under somebody and they just want to run it all by themselves, and they are missing it. If you don't stay with the master, to be with him, to stay with him and become what he wants you to become, you cannot become what you want yourself to become. So you must first come to the master, stay with the master, learn under the master, be like the master before you can become what the master wants you to become. So you cannot give what you are not. So many youths are venturing into what they don't know and are not because they are spending time to become what they are not supposed to be. You must be matured for what you are venturing into. Number three, a strategy that can destroy and that we must take care of and watch before it destroys us is company without commitment. So many youths today, full of friends, full of people around them, so much company. People come around me, come around them. They stay together, they play together, but no commitment. And I've learned in verse 14 to 15, the scripture said he joined himself with people who squandered his wealth. It was a company, but there was no commitment. They wanted his gifts, they were not ready to give him life. They wanted to eat his money, they were not ready to better his life. Any company without commitment will compound your condition. So if you do not pay attention to the issues that happen around you, then you make a shipwreck of your faith. Refuse to join company that will eat your bread and refuse you to plant your seed. Pay attention to every company that you get into that lacks commitment. Number four, desire without direction. So many youths today are full of desires. I want to be this, I want to be that, but no direction. No direction. In verse 16, the Bible says that he felt like eating the feed of the pigs, but no one gave him. That was a terrible desire, a desire that lacked direction. How would he want to eat the food of the pig? But that was a desire because there was no food. So he desired it. But that was a desire that lacked direction. That you feel like it's not enough guarantee that you should feed on. That you feel like it's not enough guarantee that you should feed on. Direction must drive your desires. And finally, engaged without enjoyment. There's a strategy of engagement. Once a man gets engaged, he feels he is there. Once a man is involved in an activity, he feels he's there. But every engagement that lacks enjoyment is a strategy that must not be implemented. So if you are doing something right now as a youth and you are not enjoying it, stop it. You can't keep doing the same thing, the same way, the same place, and expect to get a different result. No. You must stop what you are doing. Think about what you are doing, plan a new strategy, and do it differently to get a different result. So any man who says to himself, I will keep doing it. You know what the young man said? He said, how many of my father's servants have enough food to eat and to spare? And I stay here wallowing in hunger and poverty. I must go back to my father. So can I tell you something? For every one of you who are here, I want to tell you that God is saying, that if you are engaged in anything, you must enjoy what you are doing. Any strategy of engagement that lacks enjoyment is a strategy that is supposed to be abandoned and aborted. So can I tell you something? You can't keep doing the same thing the same way in the same place and get a different result. Change your strategy. If you don't like what you are doing, do something differently and do something different. And God will bless you. Never give up on yourself. Don't say, I've done it again and again and again. Do it differently. And if you can do it differently, you will get a different result. Can I tell you a story about John Watt? John Watt invested the ball. He did it 999 times. He kept failing. And he did it 1,000 times. And it succeeded. And they asked him, how come you were able to do it 1,000 times before you got it? Why were you not distracted and disappointed? He said, no, I did not do it 1,000 times per se, but I learned 999 ways that it could not be done. So for every attempt he made, he did something different. The young man said, I must not remain here. I must go back to my father. Are you engaged in a business that is killing you? Engaged in a relationship, or you are involved in something that is taking a lot of your time and you are not seeing any success? Stop it. Stop it. Do something else. I'd like to invite you that there is a different step you can make if you come to Jesus. There are many adventures and activities man can run into and do, but without Jesus, it is crisis. I want to invite you. Come to the Lord. Make a decision to return to the Master. He will accept you just as you are and make you what you are supposed to be. Shall we pray together? Our Father and our God, we thank you. Thank you for your children. Bless them and keep them. Guide them, accept them, give them a new life, give them a new ambition, give them, oh God, a new state of life, and give them proper companies that will keep them and sustain them. Thank you for hearing us pray. We give you praise and glory. Jesus, mighty name. Amen. Amen. God bless you. I'll see you again soon. In Jesus' name.
The room grew still as she made her way to Jesus. She stumbled through the tears that made her blind. She felt such pain. Some spoke in anger, heard folks whisper, there's no place here for her kind. Still on she came, through the shame that flushed her face, until at last she knelt before his feet. And though she spoke no words, everything she said was heard. as she poured her love for the master from her box of alabaster. So I've come to pour my praise on him like oil from Mary's alabaster box. Oh, I worship him. So don't be angry if I wash his feet with my tears and I dry them with my hair. Oh yeah, 'cause you weren't there the night Jesus found me. You did not feel what I felt when he wrapped his out of this oil in my alabaster box. No one knows what you've been through. I can't forget the way life used to be, 'cause I was a prisoner to the sin that had me bound. And I spend my days poured my life without measure into a little treasure box I thought I found. Oh, until the day when Jesus came to me and healed my soul with the wonder of his touch.
We pray, Lord Almighty, we pray that your word comes into everyone watching, listening at this very time in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Father, for answered prayer. For in Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. Brethren, I want us to know that the mindset of the Lord God for us, as it is given unto us in the book of Colossians 3, verse 18 to 20, it says, wives, submit yourself unto your husband as it is fit in the Lord God. This commandment is for us to understand, and it says again in 19, husband, love your wives and be not bitter against them. That is for the husband. And it goes on to say, children, obey your parents in all things, for this is well pleasing unto the Lord. There are three things mentioned in that verses read unto us. First, it talks to the wives, and as well to the husband, and thirdly to the children. And in this category, we can see the all-encompassing humanity being given for us to know and to see and to know the mindset of the Almighty God. I'll be speaking to you in the topic caption, Moving in the Will of Family in the Will of God. Moving the will of family in the will of God. It is likened to a building, and the building is asking after a process, and if that process is not well nurtured, it's not well taken care of, there could be problems along the line. And today we want to see, what does it take to move the will of a family in the will of God that will help us to understand the mindset of the Maker? And according to the word of late Dr. Miles Monroe, he said, if purpose is not known, abuse is inevitable. And the book of Psalms 11 verse 3 says, if the foundation is destroyed, what can the righteous do? I'll be speaking to all the singles watching and to all the married men and women in the house to know what it takes to enjoy the beautiful thing that the Lord has packaged for us to enjoy, either as a single or as for those who are married. This will help us to move the will of family in the will of God. And if you do this, we're able to enjoy the blessings of the Lord God Almighty. Firstly, let us understand the concept of that which is called marriage. What is marriage? It's the union of a man and a woman to become husband and wife in an holy wedlock. It's also a coming together of two different individuals with different personality traits. And in the coming together, there is a union of a man and of a woman to become one. And therefore, we must understand the very purpose to which the man and the woman come together to become husband and wife. And if you're able to understand the very purpose of God, you're able to move in the mindset of God for which the institution of marriage is established for. And I want us to understand that the concept is not just for the welfare of that which we have on a daily basis. Every weekend, every Thursdays, these days you see many young men and women going to the altar to get married. But lo and behold, the number of divorces cases we have these days is on the alarming side. And what is the result of all these things? It is as a result of the problem of not knowing the very essence of that which people go into the institution for. So I want us to know that marriage, as we always say when we have the wedding ceremony in our church, that it is instituted by God. This should be the primary focus of everyone. If you have this at the very back of our mind, we will know that God is the originator, is the founder, is the one who brings together this institution. And as it is given to us in the book of Genesis 2, verse 18 to 24, we can see the mindset of God in this. And it gives us in that Colossians 3, 18, that wives, submit to yourself unto your husband. So the first admonition goes to our women, to those who are married, women in particular. The price to pay in that your home is the price of submission. If you're able to do this in the will of God, definitely the will of your family as well will move forward. And I pray as you are watching this, whatever may be problem in your homes, the Lord Almighty today will touch your home and make your home to be sweet home in the mighty name of Jesus. Marriage is also an intimate bond. Till death do you apart. So it's a matter of life partnership. As it is given as well in that Genesis 2, 18 to 24, we need to have this and to also know that it is figurative of Christ's union with the church. Christ is the head of the church, and he gives us in that verse 19 that husbands, love your wives as Christ also loved us. So we need to have this at the very back of our mind, that if our wives submit unto us, it is also a necessity on the part of women, the husband in the house, to show them love. To show them love. And as we are doing this, God will help you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. Marriage is to be honored. And as you do that also, honor it. Many people have entered into the matrimony with defilement, all sort of things. And Bible says we should not be yoked with unbelievers. Get this into your mind. And as you are doing this, not getting yoked with unbelievers, as it is given in 2 Corinthians 6, 14 to 16, It will help you to have the mindset of God that will move the will of your family in the will of God that will make for progress. I pray for you today, as you listen and as you watch, the Lord will visit you and make everything to be perfect for you in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. If Jesus is not in your house, if Jesus is not in your home, you can call upon him today. He's ready to come into the boat of your family. He's ready to come into the will of your family. And as you are praying this prayer, if you want Jesus to come into your life, you can please say after me, husband, wives, for as many who are still trusting God for their beautiful home. And as you pray this simple prayer of conversion, and I pray for you today that the Lord God will bless you, visit you, and make your home to be sweet home in the mighty name of Jesus. Say after me, Lord Jesus, I invite you into my life, and I believe you died for me, and that your blood pays for my sin, and provide me with the gift of salvation for eternal life. Today, I accept you as my Lord and Savior. Thank you, God, for saving me now. Now I am born again. Praise the Lord. Brethren, it is good as well to join a believing Bible church for your spiritual nurturing and growth as well too. As you do this, God will bless you. And I invite you as well to worship with us in Christ Love Assembly, Bakura, Moway, Ogun State, Selby, Akindeko Street, Deeper Life Bus Stop. As you come, fellowship with us, God will bless you. And for your prayer and counseling, it is to you to call. And as you call, God will bless you. 0003983 2471. God bless you as you watch.
Someone's knocking at the door. Someone's knocking at the door. Can you hear him knocking? Can you hear him knocking? He's been knocking very long. He's been knocking for so long. Can you hear him knocking? Can you hear him knocking? Jesus, Jesus, Jesus.
He's at the door. He's at the door.
Someone's calling out your name. Calling time and time again. Can you hear him calling? Can you hear him calling?
Say a word! Speak a word!
Reverend Dr. Tunji Bangbuchi of Federal Estate Baptist Church in Abesan here in Ipaja. Today, I am dealing with the topic, the authority of the kingdom. And our text is taken from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 16. I read from verse 13. Now, when Jesus came into the district of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" And they said, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, another Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But who do you say that I am?" Simon Peter replied, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus answered him, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatever you burn on earth shall be burned in heaven, and whatever you lose on earth shall be lost in heaven. People of God, Jesus has come. He was born as a king. He has come to rule and to reign. He has come for the salvation. He has come for the healing. He has come for the deliverance of the people that are being in bondage by the power of darkness. Majorly, I'm focusing on three things. Number one, the authority of the name of Jesus. Number two, the authority of the Word of God. Number three, the authority and the power of the Holy Spirit. According to the definition of Brother Paul, which he says that the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but of righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Romans 14, verse 17. But our major concern is the authority of the kingdom which resided in Christ Jesus. As I've said to you, he was born as a king, and he has come to rule, to give power to us over sin, over darkness, and over the forces of Satan. The rule of the kingdom must be heralded throughout the whole world, that God wants to save the world from sin and death. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. According to chapter 6, verse 23. The kingdom is established and proclaimed in the following authority. 1. The authority of the name of Jesus. Bible says, he has given him a name that is above all names, and at the name of Jesus, every name must bow. The power of Satan and evil shall bow, even as you are listening to me today, in the name of Jesus. There is enough power, sufficient power in that name. It is a name that is above all names. Mention any name in the heaven, mention any name on the earth, his name is above them. And the power of the name of Jesus forces obedience into the power of darkness. If you have been attacked by the power of the evil, you have been attacked by any power anywhere, the power that is in the name of Jesus is capable to pull them down out of your life. Bible says in Mark chapter number 16, verse 15, following, and he said to them, go into all the world and proclaim the gospel to the whole creation. Whoever believes and is baptized will be saved, but whosoever does not believe will be condemned. And this sign will accompany those who believe. In my name, they will cast out demons. They will speak in new tongues. They will pick up serpents with their hands. And if they drink any deadly poison, it will not hurt them. They will lay their hands on the sick, and they will recover. Do you agree with me, dear, that there is enough power in the name of Jesus? Bible says that at the authority of the name of Jesus, the demon that are causing sickness, that are causing oppression, that are causing any problem in your life, those demons, at the mention of the authority of the name of Jesus, they will flee away. Not only that, in the authority of the name of Jesus, there is healing. Bible says when we lay our hand on the sick, no matter the type of sickness, the power in the name of Jesus is sufficient to heal that sick person, to cast out that demon behind that sickness. So the name of Jesus is the authority that we have to proclaim the rule of God, to proclaim the kingdom of God, to proclaim the salvation to the whole world. Today, the authority of the name of Jesus still saves, it still heals, it still delivers, it still settles all kinds of problems. But let me tell you this, the name of our pastor, the name of our prophet, the name of our general overseer cannot save us except the name of Jesus. The mistake people are making today is that they are making the name of their pastor, the name of their general overseer, to be above the name of Jesus. But Bible says, the name of Jesus is above all names. So everybody should stop now and focus on the name of the Lord Jesus. It's the authority, it's the power that can destroy the work of the devil. Jesus Christ also has authority to destroy the work of the devil. He has authority to forgive sin. To forgive sin. So, brethren, hold on to this authority and thou shalt be set free. Number two, the authority of the word of God. Bible says that there is power in the word of God. He sent his word. His word healed them. He saved them. He delivered them from all their affliction. The word of God has creative power. The word of God has life. The word of God has light. As you receive the word of God into your life, there shall be life, there shall be light, and darkness will never come upon you. Number three, the power of the Holy Spirit. The Lord says to his disciples, before you go into the world to proclaim my rule, to proclaim the gospel, wait and receive power from above. And that power is the power of the Holy Spirit. In the Holy Spirit is the anointing to break every yoke. If you submit today and you can confess Jesus as your Lord and Savior, the power and the authority will come upon you. And you begin to live a life of humility, a life of love, a life of peace, and life of holiness. And you begin to pray more and more. As you are doing that, that authority of the kingdom will be effective in your life. So confess Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. The day I heard the word of God that says, you must be born again, I received the word into my life and I became born again. Today too, you can receive the word of God into your life and your life will receive a new life and everything about you will change and Jesus will be the Lord. Thank you. God bless you. Let me pray with you. Father, in the name of Jesus, to all these fears, I release the authority that is in the name of Jesus. I release the power and the authority that is in the word of the Lord. I release the power and the anointing that is the Holy Spirit to deliver them from sin, to deliver them from all their affliction, that the Lord will give you a new heart and a new life. Thank you, Almighty God. In Jesus' name, I have prayed. Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Coming into His presence. I felt the touch. If you know you were feeling the touch, can you just wave it against the Lord and say, God, thank you. You don't understand. His presence given to God. Are you with me? His presence is strong. Hallelujah. Because he's an awesome God. Because he's what? An awesome God. I want to do something tonight. Just put your hands together for his awesomeness. Good stuff. Good stuff. I'm
Jesus, precious Jesus.
We'll be right back.